Hello, I am Amanda Arnold. Welcome to my channel, A Billion Baby Steps. I am going to talk today about where we are in the fertility process. Last video, I discussed a little bit of the background that we've had with infertility. We've been trying on and off for 4 years, going to a fertility specialist for over a year now, about a year and a half, and haven't had any success with a viable pregnancy. Had an early miscarriage known as a biochemical pregnancy, which is fairly common. Good sign though, because it means we can get pregnant. They thought I would be responding very well to all the other treatment, and unfortunately I did get pregnant one more time, and that was an ectopic pregnancy where it was located in the incorrect place. They couldn't find where it was, not sure if it was in my tube, my cervix. And so we're now moving into the IVF process, and I wanna talk today about that. I wanna talk about the prep for it, the cost of it, and then kind of the timeline of IVF. And we are actually starting, Kyle and I are starting the process next Friday. And up to this point, at this time in preparing for IVF, I'm actually taking a ton of supplements. I put a few of them down here, and I'm gonna talk about those in a second. And I wanna talk really about the cost of it, because I think a lot of people wonder about that. Also, we're doing this raffle and this fundraiser, and I wanna kind of explain why Kyle and I decided to do that, and like the cost of it itself. Just for the egg retrieval and the embryo transfer, which egg retrieval is where they pull all your the eggs out of you after they pump you up with hormones. They're gonna try to pull as many eggs out of you as they can. And then you go back a couple months later and they plop an embryo into you. And they'll do that, this particular package with my IVF clinic, they'll actually put an embryo in me. It's included in this package to do it as many times as it takes for a year. But the cost is $17,024 before we even look at medication. This also doesn't include all the money we've already paid up front for all the IUI procedures, all the fertility medications. This doesn't include blood panels and everything we've had up to this point. This also does not include the medication, which can cost anywhere from $4,000 to $8,000, depending on how much I need. And this also doesn't include another $2,000 we have to pay to the genetic testing lab. So if you take the extra $2,000 added on to the $17,000, that brings us to $19,000, and then another possibly $4,000 to $6,000. That would bring us to $23,000 to $25,000 for essentially one kind of process of IVF from start to finish. Package that my clinic does is kind of nice, because like I said, they allow me to, it's the ultrasounds. So when I'm doing all these hormones, I'm highly monitored. I'm going back every other day so that they can do an ultrasound, they can look at my ovaries, they can make sure my eggs are growing the right amount, not too much, not too little, and that we know exactly when we need to take those eggs out. So pretty much stimulation goes for like around 2 weeks. I'm gonna start next Friday, and they expect 2 weeks after that will be potentially when I'll have my egg retrieval, which at that point they'll go right up through my cervix and they'll basically take a little tubule and suck out all the eggs out of my ovaries, all the mature follicles. And a normal woman's cycle, you have one egg drop, right? Like an average cycle, you'll have one egg come out through your fallopian tubes, and then when sperm enters that egg, that's when it gets fertilized, and few days later it turns into an embryo. Actually take the sperm and push it right into the egg. That's a process with IVF called ICSI, I-C-S-I, where they actually will push the sperm in instead of just putting sperm near the egg. So they're gonna push it right in there. That boosts your chances for fertilization a little bit, potentially. It also raises your chances of having an identical twin, because they say that that little splice by pushing the sperm in can kind of help that egg split in half once it becomes fertilized, which is when you get identical twins. Up to that point, you know, you're getting your hormones, you're going to the doctor every other day and getting monitored. Then what's gonna happen on the procedure day is your partner or your sperm donor is there when you're getting your egg retrieval done. So I'm gonna go under anesthesia for the egg retrieval. And my mom's gonna come to that appointment with us, and she's going to just be there so that afterwards, if I need any help, or my husband has to work, or he's got plans, and she can be around in case I have any ovarian hyperstimulation syndrome. So after you get all those eggs into your ovaries, they get really swollen and you could have some pain afterwards. But Kyle basically will go in, my husband, and he'll provide his sperm sample, and then they're gonna pull the eggs out. While I'm asleep, I will wake up and they'll tell me, this is how many eggs we retrieved. And then I think a day later, they tell me how many have fertilized. And like I said, they push the sperm right in there. So women with PCOS like myself, I probably will have more eggs that they will end up, that will mature, because people with PCOS have more eggs in a given cycle. Our quality of eggs are lower. So even though I get more eggs, we might end up with less fertilized embryos. And then after fertilization, the numbers will then kind of start to dwindle from there. So say we end up, they pull 20 eggs from my ovaries. And then say 15 of those eggs fertilize, they're gonna actually want to see those grow to 5-day embryo. They call it a 5-day blastocyst. And so what's gonna happen after it's fertilized, it's gonna keep dividing and dividing and dividing and dividing, to the point where it's becoming the beginning of an embryo. Anything that makes it to 5 days, that's good. We want that. We want it to go to 5 days. They grow that in like a temperature environment that's similar to a uterus. They even say it's even better. So we're giving ourselves better chances of getting to that 5th day. And then from there, anything that looks good, they're gonna look at it and they grade it on a scale. Any of them that look really good and like they'll be able to be frozen will be frozen. Before they're frozen, they're actually gonna pluck out a couple of the cells and they're gonna take them to go to a genetic testing biopsy facility. That's the extra $2,000 I mentioned. So our clinic requires genetic testing for this particular package because it improves the likelihood that you're gonna have a viable pregnancy. So a lot of women with fertility issues, we have instances where we get pregnant and it doesn't last because the embryo had maybe potentially some kind of genetic or chromosomal abnormality. So this particular genetic testing, and there's many, many types, but they're just gonna test for the chromosomes to make sure there's none extra or there's none missing. And so that's gonna boost the chances of a viable pregnancy, reduce the chances of miscarriage. So that is kind of where we're at with the next step procedure. Now, I talked about pricing, I talked about kind of where we're at in the process and what the next steps are with the egg retrieval. I want to talk a little bit about the supplements. So starting over here, this is prenatal, you know, that's a basic one. Most women take that when they're trying to get pregnant. One of the things I will tell you, it starts with the egg book, is a really great book about the supplement process, how to prepare yourself. It talks a lot about getting rid of plastics because it's been shown to cause infertility, especially BPA. There's been proof that it makes people infertile. And so I would highly recommend that book if anybody is trying to conceive and having any difficulty. There's diet recommendations. But one of the things that she talks about with your prenatal is to get something with folate or methylfolate instead of folic acid. And the reason for that is that folic acid is the synthetic form. Methylfolate is a naturally occurring active form of folic acid. So also some women apparently can't break down folic acid in their bodies as easily as others. I think it's like something like 25% of women need to have folate as opposed to folic acid. So just one thing to take note of. The next thing is myo-inositol. This one is really great for PCOS. It regulates your cycle. It can help you ovulate. It's an antioxidant and it helps fight free radicals. It's really great for metabolic and mood disorders. And like I said, for PCOS, it comes highly recommended. And it's really great for ovarian and reproductive health. Next is ubiquinol. Now, basically this is the more absorbable form of CoQ10. And if you've ever taken, you know, if you're into supplements, CoQ10 is really great for your heart. It's great for cellular energy. And this is the absorbable version. It's a little more expensive, but if your body takes in more of it, then why not, right? Maca, I've been taking this for like 4 years, ever since we started getting pregnant. It's a superfood of all natural plant root native to Peru. And it increases your fertility and your sex drive. It enhances your energy and your stamina. So that's a good one. DHA, this one is a type of omega-3 fat. It's plentiful in oily fish like salmon and anchovies. It reduces inflammation and improves fetal development. So you'll see a theme of the research that they're doing. And there's a high lack of research on infertility, in my opinion. They don't know much about PCOS. There's a lot of unexplained infertility. But a lot of these supplements help with inflammation. Anything that helps with inflammation is most likely gonna help with fertility and other things as well. Immune system response, energy in your cells. So that's kind of a common thread. Vitamin D, that's the sunshine vitamin. This one comes with K2. So this is vitamin D3 plus K2. K2 helps D3 get absorbed better. A lot of people don't have sufficient vitamin D, so that's a good one to take. Anyway, it's really good for, it's shown to increase fertility, especially with people with PCOS. L-carnitine, that is an antioxidant. I read that it deposits fat into cells to boost their energy, helps treat female fertility specifically with PCOS. Liposomal vitamin C. So we all know vitamin C is kind of the energy vitamin, major antioxidant. The liposomal is easier to absorb because it's fat soluble. So they recommend doing that one over just basic vitamin C. B complex, B is like a energy vitamin, so that has all the B vitamins. Vitamin E, it's a major antioxidant as well. Boost reproductive health in men and women. N-acetyl-L-cysteine, also known as NAC, that's a form of cysteine found in high protein foods. It reduces inflammation. It's also good for men. It increases fertility with people with PCOS by improving ovulation and regulating ovulation. Women's probiotic, this helps with your immune system, your digestive health, your, you know, reproductive flora and fauna. So that's also a good one to take because I'm actually right now on antibiotics. My husband and I are taking antibiotics to make sure we have no infections in our body before we go into IVF, and probiotics help balance out the good bacteria. And then lastly, melatonin. So melatonin, a lot of people take this to sleep, of course. It is actually, it's a hormone, and this has been actually proven to improve IVF results, improve fertilization rates, and improve embryo quality. So this is highly recommended to take every single night at bedtime, because it does make you sleepy, which is what a lot of people take it for. And the supplements, they say, what I've read in the books and a couple other things, they say take about 3 months to really fully start building up in your body and seeing results from it. So ideally, if you start taking these supplements 3 months before you go into the IVF process, you're doing yourself a huge service. I'm just trying to do everything I can to set myself up for success at this point. And we're already spending $25,000 as it is, might as well throw in a few extra bucks for things they think could help. So that's supplements. And then lastly is what is coming up in the process. So I've got my IVF calendar, and this basically is, you know, kind of giving me the guidelines of the shots that I'm gonna take. I haven't received the shots yet. They're coming tomorrow. I'll share that more about that when I start preparing for that process. And so the calendar is basically just showing me like which of the hormones to take. I also will get a phone call every day from my doctor about upping the dosages, lowering the dosages. Because of those ultrasounds, they are monitoring me highly. They're gonna tell me if I need to boost anything or change anything throughout. I could run out of fertility medication. If I get close to doing that, I'll order more. A lot of the fertility shots are like refrigerated, so you have to get them overnighted in like a refrigerated package. But basically, we're gonna be starting on the 14th with an ultrasound. They'll check everything out. They'll make sure I look good to go. And then I'll start doing the shots and the injections, and we'll guide you through that process when that starts. I'm sure Kyle will thoroughly enjoy that. And then the next 2 weeks, I'll be doing those shots, and I'll be tracking kind of the way that that progresses and how many follicles are growing, how many eggs are, you know, mature. And then the next step is I'll be walking everybody through how many they retrieve from me, how many fertilize, how many make it to day 5, and then how many they test are normal. So we could start with 30 eggs, and then it could drop down to a few embryos that are actually healthy enough to freeze. They want to make sure they all last through a freezing, because they do freeze them. So essentially, once we have the embryos and they're developed and they look good and they're 5 days, a 5 day blastocyst, then they'll freeze them. And then we'll let my body rest for a couple months. And then I start preparing for the frozen egg transfer. So, and we'll walk through that process too. But that's basically the latest for us. I did want to let everybody know again, thank you so much for everybody who's called, written a text message, responded to any of my posts, saw the videos. Just phenomenal response from people. And this is empowering for me. This is an empowering thing to discuss. I'm excited about this next step. I'm excited about taking control over my fertility, sharing the story with you guys. It really just helps me to feel like I release all this tension and negativity and shame that comes with being, you know, in the quote unquote trying to conceive community. I think we're gonna beat it. I'm excited. And I just really appreciate everybody's support. The raffle is, we've raised like $2,500 at this point. So, I mean, it's just really amazing, you know, that we've seen this incredible response from our loved ones. And I can't thank everybody enough. This has been just a tremendous experience for me. So I'm gonna keep posting about this, and any questions, please let me know. I do, after my IVF process, I want to start interviewing other women and sharing their stories, men as well. I wanna have Kyle on in a future video too. And so, yeah, there's just more to come. And thank you guys so much for following our journey of a billion baby steps. So until next time, you guys take care.